I'm a current faculty member in the College of Education, as well as a Concordia University alumna. After graduating in 1998, I became a second and third grade teacher in the Lake Oswego School District. I soon moved to Washington and became a mommy full-time for a few years. When the kids started preschool, I decided to teach pre-K in order to keep my skills polished, but it also gave me an opportunity to explore early childhood education and focus on my master's degree research, which targeted language development. Upon finishing my master's degree, I was ready for something more, and that's when CU called, needing a supervisor in the College of Education. It feels like a whirlwind, and I became a full-time employee with roles such as academic advisor, assistant program director, and quickly turned into my current role as the director of undergraduate studies in the College of Education and professor. I'm most proud of the relationships I've built with students, and I believe that relationships are the key to movement forward. My time also was spent co-chairing the licensure committee for 3 to PhD and implementing the redesign of the undergraduate licensure program. I'm passionate about teacher preparation and mentorship and hope to continue in that role. The facts of life. Where do you see yourself tomorrow, next week, next year? For most of my young adult life, I didn't look ahead or plan my future. However, I kept my eyes open and carefully stepped into the opportunities that were in front of me, and typically, I was scared silly. I remember friends talking about the excitement of getting their driver's license, and I couldn't imagine getting behind the wheel of a car. Or when they talked to me about graduating from high school, and I couldn't imagine walking across the stage. For that same matter, going to college, I couldn't see myself going anywhere. It was at that same time when it came to getting married, or teaching solo for the first time, or having children. The fact is, I did all of those things, and for all intents and purposes, I've done them well. But as I reflect back, I wonder what could have happened had I imagined the possibilities, if I had the perspective to visualize my life. Nothing has been perfect in my life, but I have led a privileged life. It took me 2 tries to get my driver's license. I graduated from high school at age 17. Like I said, I didn't go away to college. I stayed in town and I went to the community college. Then I transferred to Concordia. I got married before I graduated from college, and I spent a semester focused on wedding plans rather than my religion class. I took my first teaching job in an area of town with highly intelligent parents who didn't want their children to have the new teacher. I had 3 children in 4 years. Insane. One day, I started to visualize, when this third baby goes to kindergarten, where do I want to be? What do I want to be doing? I knew I wanted to be back in the classroom. I'd been out of the public school system for a few years. So what did I do? Well, it was that August I decided to call CU and start my master's degree. And they said, great, you'll start in a couple of days. What? That's how I did things, just quickly. I spent the next 2 years taking online classes every 6 weeks. I'd put the children to bed and start my homework at 8 o'clock at night, go to bed at midnight, drag myself up the next morning, and do it all again. I had 3 small children, a husband that traveled, I was teaching half-time, and I was coaching 2 soccer teams. But I was organized, and I did all the mom things. And then I achieved my goal. I had my master's degree. Now what? I didn't know how to just be. I had resigned from my teaching job, but I didn't have another job lined up. I thought, no problem. I'll just be. I'll be the best mom, but my kids were in school. My friends all had jobs. I decided I'd take up running. I ran with a girlfriend, and I was doing really well. Except I would come home and I'd lay down and I'd go to sleep. I wasn't ready to admit that there was something wrong. I would force myself to be that mom when my kids came home from school every day, and then I would collapse. One day I faced reality. I was depressed. But what did I need? How was I going to help myself? I needed a purpose. Don't get me wrong, being a mom is the best thing I've ever done. I wouldn't trade it for anything in my life, but I needed more. I'm not an awesome stay-at-home-all-day type of mom. In fact, quite annoying. I needed a job, so I started subbing, and soon CU called, and they needed a supervisor and someone to teach a class at night. And that small start quickly rolled into full-time employment. I'd like to share these facts with you, these facts of life with you. As I tell my students, it's important to give directions in sets of three. It allows us a greater chance to remember things. It's like when I stop at the grocery store. If I have three things on my list, I can pick them up, but if there's a fourth and I didn't make the list, it doesn't happen. I also believe in the power of acronyms and alliteration. So please enjoy these facts of life. F, friendship. When it comes to anything in life, relationships, friendships, the work you do, the art you make, when it comes to anything, if it does not create an avalanche within your chest, if it does not move you and inspire you, if it does not come from the deepest part of you, then it's not for you. Let's focus on friendships for a minute. And really by friendships, I really want to talk to you about relationships. Friendships will come and go. This always makes me think of Ecclesiastes. To everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. I've had many friendships that have been seasonal. That does not mean they have not been important. They were what I needed at that point in my life. Some of those friendships I have grieved over the years and wondered, what happened? Where did they go? Some of those friendships I've gladly moved on from. There are personal friendships, situational friendships, the parents from my kids' soccer team, the nice parents I met during music class, and then there's also work friendships. Let me try to explain the difference. In a friendship, I don't rely on the other person when I make decisions, big or small. I may communicate with them, talk through scenarios, but they are not making a decision with me. Whereas with relationships, there's a connection in which I rely on the other person to guide and help me make my decision, because my decision will impact them in some way or another. There is a high level of openness and trust. I pride myself on creating relationships with the people that matter. And the people that matter right now, during this season of my life, are my colleagues, but most importantly, my students. As CU announced closure April 2020, I started to grieve the friendships that I've made over the last 8 years. It felt guttural, surreal, and unimaginable to say goodbye. Like most people, I buried those feelings and got to work guiding students on their new education paths. It was through that process that I realized I've built relationships with students and colleagues, that there's a level of trust in which I don't have to let that go. I think the component that scared me the most was losing touch with everyone. I'm not good at staying in touch. I'm a good communicator when someone is in my daily realm, but otherwise, not so much. So I started to think of how I would make that happen, and then I realized I've already put my tools in place through social media. While social media can be daunting for some, for me, it has been an incredible way to stay connected to everyone. Earlier this spring, I was reviewing some data for accreditation, and I started digging around out of curiosity to see how many students I've come in contact with the College of Education since I arrived. 500 students. And this number is small, as I only looked at my undergraduate students. There are other students, like my online early childhood students, my master's students, and all the students across other disciplines on this campus that I've worked with. My number of impacted students is much smaller than my colleagues who teach general education courses. But that number 500 students set me on a course of reflection. Where are those students? Have I remained present in their life? I then checked one of my social media accounts and saw that I have over 500 friends. And while this is a loose connection, I was proud. I've seen students share the joy of teaching. I've seen students share their frustration of teaching, especially online right now. I've seen marriages, babies born, and even death. So as we think about the facts of life, I challenge you to build friendly relationships. How are you getting to know your peers and colleagues? How are you building trust? There will always be friendships that come and go, but what are you doing to build that relationship? When I was in fifth grade, I was in a talent show with a few of my besties. One of them, Heather, is a twin, and we're still in close in contact today, not daily, not weekly, but we keep in touch. We decided to enter the talent show with a few other friends and sang, "Thank You for Being a Friend" from the Golden Girls. It was about 1985, and the show was very popular. And while I won't sing for you today, although I do sing and dance while teaching, I just want you to remember that. Thank you for being a friend. Build the relationships, make your relationships count. Be supportive, stand up, and outside of your comfort zone, grow together and be transparent and honest. Fact of life, letter A, adjust. When life gives you lemons, make lemonade. It all happens for a reason. It's a marathon, not a sprint. When it rains, it pours. It takes grit. And my all-time favorite, with my eyes rolling, is just breathe. While these statements try to provide hope and guidance, there are times when we don't want to hear them. We want to wallow, we want to be angry, and we can't get out of our way. So this fact of life, adjust. Often our struggle about adjusting is the fear that comes with it. I had a conversation this week with someone who is struggling with some college content. The person is very frustrated and said to me, "You've been telling me that I can do this for 5 years and nothing has changed. I still can't do it." Fair enough, but my response was, "You've been doing it the same way for 5 years. You have to adjust. You have to make a change. You have to accept help. Stop letting fear rule you. We fear failure. Now, there are also fears and phobias that require medical intervention, and I'm not talking about those. There are also fears that I will never experience like you experience. But still the same, we all have our fears. According to Psychology Today, fear is a vital response to physical and emotional danger. Fear is commonly referred to as fight or flight. Our brain shuts down. Fear prepares us to react to danger. Once we suspect a potential danger, our body releases hormones that slow or shut down functions that aren't needed for survival. It sharpens functions that might help us survive, such as our eyesight. Our heart rate increases, our blood flows to muscles so that we can run faster. In the College of Education, we teach our future teachers about the brain and how kids can flip their lids. When they go into fear, the lid is flipped. And until we can get that lid to come back down, there is zero focus or learning, but more on that in a minute. Has anyone been going through something emotional lately? Yes, we all have. February 10th. All of our lives changed through those small words. Concordia will cease to operate. And then, a few weeks later, we were forced into quarantine. For faculty and students, this meant beginning to manage classes online. Do you know how many people have told me I hate online classes? There's a reason I'm on this campus taking classes. And while I'm extremely empathetic, and it's not what I would have chosen or anyone else, it's what we have to do. We don't have a choice. We have to adjust. Do you know how many times I've failed at something before I found success? Failed my first driving test. Ugh, embarrassed. I was performing at a Sonics basketball game, and in the middle of the dance, I forgot the steps. So there I was, step touch, step touch, step touch. I have failed an exam, I've missed a deadline. I fell down the bleachers during the middle of a high school basketball game. And there are other failures that are too deep to share in this context. But sometimes we have to set our fear aside and make the adjustment because we are in charge. I remember the first time I escorted a group of students out of the country. I decided I would step in and help out, and I was thrilled to get to travel. There was only one problem. I had never traveled to that country. The morning I stepped on the plane, I thought, what am I doing? I have no idea what I'm doing. I don't know the language. I don't know how to get around. I don't understand the currency, but I just had to adjust and step into the situation. So I asked a lot of questions, and I allowed everyone in the group to step up and do their part. One student was a great map reader. So I said, great, you're in charge. Another student loved language. Great, you can help us communicate. I remember sitting on a train with my coworker and best friend. The train had stopped and we stayed in place for about an hour. Announcements were made about what was happening, but we didn't know the language, so we adjusted. We pulled out snacks and card games and entertained the college students while we waited for the train to start moving. There's so many stories like this of these practical adjustments that had to be made. But in order to make the adjustments, I had to remain calm. So, how do we make the adjustment? Especially when we don't want to or can't because we flipped our brain. Let's talk about flipping our brain. Your thumb is the middle of your brain, the amygdala, or where the emotion is. Your fingertips fold around it as your prefrontal cortex, the front of your brain where we think and reason. The flip is the prefrontal cortex lid. It's that save your life, fight or flight. I see flames, my amygdala makes me run, there's no thinking or reasoning, I need to get out. We need the amygdala, the emotion, but it can make mountains out of molehills. When your lid is flipped, your thoughts and emotions become muddled. When the lid is flipped, you have to find a way to bring that prefrontal cortex back down. Before a test, a presentation, etc. Bringing the lid down can be tough for all of us, but I believe and encourage students to have their go-to list. What things help me adjust? Find my calm, my center. I want you to stop now and think about those things that make you happy. One, two, and three. For me, it's everything from deep belly breaths to music. That can be instrumental or dance music. It can be a walk outside, lighting a candle, or spending time with my animals. They always love me. It just depends where I am and at that moment. Okay, so you've started to make your go-to list. I encourage the go-to list because remember, when the brain is flipped, we're not thinking as clearly. Let's practice some deep belly breaths. A big deep breath to the count of four, then we hold it for two and let it out slowly for six counts. We call it the 4-2-6. Here we go, deep breath. One, two, three, four, hold, two, and release. Two, three, four, five, and six. One more time. Breathe in, one, two, three, four, hold, two, and out. Two, three, four, five, six. Another strategy is gratitude. When life is overwhelming and giving you lemons and someone told you to just breathe again, turn it around through gratitude. What makes you thankful every day? These gratitudes can certainly be big, like, oh, I'm thankful I have a job. But I encourage you to look for the small gratitudes as well. One of my small gratitudes is my favorite mug. It feels just right, and it's full of inspirational quotes all the way around it. It's from a former preschool teacher mom who left us too soon. She was full of gratitude and had the best hashtags, like, be brave even when it's hard, and reach for your best friends. It's all of those reminders that bring me gratitude. Show your gratitude. You don't need a fancy journal, but maybe that's your thing. Write them down, use your phone, your whiteboard, your bathroom mirror. Just write them down each day. In the words of Rachel Hollis, and if you don't know Rachel, Google her, know this one great truth. You are in control of your own life. You get one and only one chance to live, and life is passing you by. Stop beating yourself up, and dang it, stop letting others do it too. Stop accepting less than you deserve. Stop buying things you can't afford to impress people you don't even really like. Stop eating your feelings instead of working through them. Stop buying your kids love with food or toys or friendship because it's easier than parenting. Stop abusing your body and your mind. Stop. Just get off the never-ending track. Fact number three, cue, or question. Do not take anything for granted. You are smart. You are intelligent. Reflect critically and question. Now, this does not mean to not trust. We talked about trusting friendly relationships. And this doesn't mean to be the person in class who verbally questions everything your professor, colleagues, friend, administrator, etc. says to you. But I do encourage you to think, wonder, and question rather than taking things for granted. I put this idea of questioning into two different buckets. Bucket one is all things academic, schoolwork and media. You do not need to be enrolled in a fancy program to continue learning. However, side note to my education students, you will finish your degrees you have started. That doesn't mean you stop learning. You can always learn. Question and wonder. How do you model this learning for others? What books will you read? What songs will you learn? What deep conversations will you participate in? Use technology to enroll in a free class or watch a documentary, listen to podcasts, keep reading, attend conferences or community events. Above all, stay engaged. The second bucket is yourself. This also means questioning yourself through critical reflection. How am I doing? Am I being a good friend? Am I building solid relationships? Am I putting in effort to the people around me, or am I solely focused on me? How do you listen to what others have to say? Listening is a hard skill. What you have to say is important, but what others have to say is just as important. I tell my kids all the time, learn to listen to others. Do not just respond with your own opinion. The HuffPost developed an article about listening. Learning to listen means learning to actually pay attention to concentrate on what other people are saying, listening to their words as if listening to a favorite song, with your mind focused on what they are saying and what it means. The first step in learning to listen is to learn to be quiet. Are you the person that has your remark locked and loaded, ready to let it fly? Or are you paying attention, intently focused and concentrating on the person, their tone, their demeanor? Are you listening to understand and then question? I really believe in the I wonder statements. Rather than saying, no, you're wrong, or here's my thought, I try to phrase my thoughts in ways that allow for respect and a productive conversation. I encourage you all to continue your education, to go beyond the thought of this is what I have to do, and instead think of it as this is what I get to do. I encourage you to become the person you need to become. I had a student, Kent, curly blonde hair little boy, little second grader, who wanted to play the piano and sing and dance. I believe he took some heat from his buddies about his decision, but he kept up with his passions, and eventually I got a Facebook message from him. It was his senior year, I believe, of high school, and he was in the high school musical Beauty and the Beast. He was Lumiere, the candelabra. I bought tickets for my daughter and I, and we went and watched the performance. I hadn't seen Kent for a few years, but we had kept in touch with Christmas cards and birthday cards. He and I share a birthday, and he has a pretty fantastic mom who keeps us in touch. I watched the performance that night with pride and joy and tears. I was so proud of him. He had overcome his own fears, but also he'd kept his arms up in the air for 2 hours as he performed as Lumiere. It was a joy to watch his joy. His dream later was to become a blue man. And while those dreams didn't happen, he continued to persevere and started to perform on his homemade created rimba tubes. He performed throughout college, and one day I got a note that he'd be performing his big first concert in Portland. And you better believe I was there. So were former friends of his, other teachers, and our former principal. You see, we didn't just build a friendship, we built a relationship. I don't talk to him daily or monthly, but I'm always watching and cheering him forward. He had fear and he made adjustments to continue moving forward, and he certainly questioned his every move and created himself to be the best person he wants to be. And he's not done yet. Check him out. You can Google him, Snubby J. My hope and dream as we all move forward with our goals is to remember the three facts. The three facts of life: friendship, adjustment, and question. I can be found on most forms of social media. Reach out. I'd love to stay connected. Thanks for being a friend.